My dear brothers and sisters, this session is about the war of Kurukshetra on which the Gita is based and gives one justification, at least one justification for this war based on a passage from Sri Aurobindo's essays on the Gita. But before I go further, the 11 blessings of the Mother and Sri Aurobindo to all of you from Sri Aurobindo Ashram, Delhi branch. And not only the critics of the Gita, but also the admirers of the Gita who have learned a lot from the Gita and in fact have a great deal of reverence for the Gita, are sometimes uncomfortable with the idea that Sri Krishna, who was God in human form, not only condones violence, but in fact recommends violence to Arjuna and urges him to fight and kill the Kauravas. And he tells him that kill them. The decision to kill them has already been taken by me. You be the instrument to carry out this task and thereby win the war and earn glory and rule a prosperous kingdom. Now, they're very uncomfortable with this idea that Arjuna should do all this at the bidding, the urging, almost a command from the divine itself. Well, a lot can be said in defense of the war which Sri Krishna recommended, and that will be primarily about something that applies to all the work that we do, that is the motive behind the work and the manner in which we do it and the spirit with which we do it. But today we'll not go into all those details. Today we shall discuss this topic in light of a passage from Sri Aurobindo's essays on the Gita. This passage occurs on page 200 in my edition of the Gita, in my edition of Essays on the Gita. And Sri Aurobindo says in this passage, equality too there shall be with regard to the action of others upon us. Nothing that they can do will alter the inner oneness, love, sympathy, which arise from the perception of the one self in all, the divine in all beings. But a resigned forbearance and submission to them and their deeds, a passive non-resistance, will be no necessary part of the action. It cannot be, since a constant instrumental obedience to the divine and universal will must mean in the shock of opposite forces that fill the world, a conflict with personal wills which seek rather their own egoistic satisfaction. Therefore, Arjuna is bidden to resist, to fight, to conquer, but to fight without hatred or personal desire or personal enmity or antagonism, since to the liberated soul these feelings are impossible. Now let me try to paraphrase this passage. Equality too there shall be with regard to the action of others upon us. Now Sri Aurobindo uses the word equality instead of equanimity because equality goes a step beyond. Equanimity can be due to philosophical indifference, you know, or due to just being a mature person. I've seen everything in life, now nothing affects me. But equality means receiving everything that we get in life with equal delight, looking upon fortune and misfortune equally, treating them both as a gift from the divine and using them for the purpose for which they have been given and accepting them delightfully because both fortune and misfortune, pleasant and unpleasant events, can help us grow spiritually, which is the very purpose of life. So that is what equality is. And Sri Aurobindo has used it as a better translation of what the Gita calls samatva. Samatva is equality rather than just equanimity. So equality too, there shall be with regard to the action of others upon us. Equality too, there shall be. Well, I mean, seems a little out of context, but Sri Aurobindo has described before this in the chapter that in what all circumstances one can remain equal, that is accept everything with equal delight. And here is one more situation in which he says equality should be there in this situation also. And what is that situation? Well, in regard to the action of others upon us, that is others who have hurt us, insulted us, In relation to these also, there shall be equality. That is, we shall maintain our poise and we shall remain equal, accept this also with the same delight with which we would accept praise or appreciation. So insult and praise, both shall be accepted with equal delight. So equality too there will be with regard to the action of others upon us. So those others who have hurt us in some way, in relation to them also, we should maintain equality. Nothing that they can do will alter the inner oneness, love, sympathy, which arise from the perception of the oneself in all. Now, this is the reason why we shall maintain equality. And this is the knowledge that will help us maintain that equality. Because even those who have hurt us are a manifestation of the divine. They are the divine in another form. And because we are also manifestations of the same divine. And if they are imperfect, we are also imperfect. And therefore, we shall have for them a lot of love, feel a sense of oneness with them, and have sympathy for them in spite of what they have done to us. And this is what will help us maintain equality, even in relation to those who have not been nice to us. So no matter what their action has been upon us, we shall still maintain that equality. Nothing that they can do will alter the inner oneness, love, sympathy, which arise from the perception of the one self in all, the divine in all beings. But a resigned forbearance and submission to them and their deeds, a passive non-resistance, will be no necessary part of the action. So having love and sympathy for them is also an action. But then from this, it does not follow that we shall also have a resigned forbearance. That is, just accept without any protest, without resistance, whatever they do and whatever they say. But a resigned forbearance and submission to them and their deeds, a passive non-resistance, that is offering no resistance and remaining passive, will be no necessary part of the action, will not be a part of the action that we take. It cannot be. And why it cannot be? Since a constant instrumental obedience to the divine and universal will must mean in the shock of opposite forces that fill the world, a conflict with personal wills which seek rather their own egoistic satisfaction. Because we'll find in the world lots of people with their own personal wills, and some of these personal wills could be quite opposite in character, and you cannot have this same type of resigned attitude to all those opposite attitudes in the world. Not only that, if all these opposite forces are in one way or the other designed or motivated by the egoistic satisfaction of these people who have these personal wills, then we, as an instrument of the divine, cannot agree with that will and will find a way of protesting. So, but a resigned forbearance and submission to them and their deeds, a passive non-resistance, will be no necessary part of the action. It cannot be. Why it cannot be? Since a constant instrumental obedience to the divine and universal will, you know, we are instruments of the divine on the path of yoga. And that's what Arjuna was also told, be an instrument of the divine, nimitta matram bhava, Sri Krishna tells him. So it cannot be, since a constant instrumental obedience to the divine and universal will, the divine will and the universal will, you know, can be taken as synonymous. Since a constant instrumental obedience to the divine and universal will must mean in the shock of opposite forces that fill the world, a conflict with personal wills which seek rather their own egoistic satisfaction. So we are an instrument of the divine, and we are trying our best to striving to know what the divine will is. On the other hand, we are faced all around by many of these people who might have hurt us, who may not have hurt us, that their personal wills are in conflict with the divine will of which we have decided to be an instrument. Their will is motivated by their own egoistic satisfaction. And therefore, we cannot be both. We cannot agree with these personal wills which come in conflict with the divine will and also be an instrument of the divine will. And for this reason, passive non-resistance, submission, resigned forbearance, that is tolerance without any protest, cannot be a part of our action, in spite of the fact that we'll continue to love them, continue to feel one with them, because they are also manifestations of the same divine. Therefore, Arjuna is bidden to resist. Arjuna is told, you should resist the Kauravas, to fight, not only resist them, fight with them, to conquer, but to fight. Now, this is the most important. Fight, yes, but how to fight? But to fight without hatred or personal desire or personal enmity or antagonism. Without these three things, without hatred, fight, but have no hatred for the Kauravas, or personal desire. You're not fighting for the sake of getting the kingdom. That desire Arjuna had already overcome, and that is why he didn't want to fight. So fight, in fact, fight not only in spite of the fact that you do not want the kingdom, fight without that desire. Fight without hatred for the Kauravas, fight without personal desire, or personal enmity or antagonism. Fight without a feeling, sense of personal enmity with individuals who are your opponents, or antagonism. That is, without any personal opposition, since to the liberated soul, these feelings are impossible. Now, who is a liberated soul? The one who has achieved perfection on the path of yoga. And what does this liberated soul mean? His soul has been liberated from the clutches of the ego and all that follows from it, the desires and the hatred and enmity. These are all a part of that ego. The ego, between which and the soul, there is a barrier. Once that barrier has been removed, we let all parts of our being, particularly our feelings and thoughts, get illumined by our divine essence, the soul. Then we are liberated. Then these feelings become impossible. Because once the feelings and thoughts have been illumined by the soul, we cannot have these feelings. We'll be full of love for everybody. And therefore, it should be easy for Arjun, if he has reached or is near that point where one would reach. You know, again, that's important, because our actions influence our consciousness, and our consciousness influences our action. So even if one has not reached the peak, is not totally liberated, actions which are consistent with that liberation will take us towards that liberation. And as we move towards that liberation, the actions will become more and more consistent with the liberation. So both these things go hand in hand. And therefore, he is told that to a liberated soul, that is a soul which is illumining the person's thoughts and feelings, will be able to see that others are also a manifestation of the divine, and therefore have only the emotion of love towards them, which is inspired by a sense of oneness, because they are manifestations of the divine and we are manifestations of the divine. And therefore, enmity, hatred, antagonism will be impossible. So without those feelings towards the Kauravas, towards any individuals in the Kaurava army, fight, and without any personal desire. So the justification for the war given here is very difficult to put into practice. But all the same, that is the type of conditions under which Arjun wanted him to fight. So to conclude, one should love all, and one can love all without liking everybody. So we should love all, but we don't have to like all, and we don't have to approve of everything that they do. And if the duty and circumstances demand, we should be ready to put up a fight in the same spirit in which Sri Krishna advises Arjuna to fight. So that's again important. If duty and circumstances demand, in this case, it was demanded of Arjuna in these circumstances, because his duty was, as a Kshatriya, to protect the society from injustice and evil. So to defend good and justice, it was his duty to fight. Those were the norms of the period during which this was going on. But then this sort of situations in which one can easily extrapolate this knowledge can be found even today. So it was his duty and the circumstances. The circumstances were that the Kauravas had done something which had led to a justified war. All other options had been exhausted. And here now had come that point at which the battle was about to begin. And since it was a battle which had reached this point after exhausting all options, and it was Arjun's duty in these circumstances to fight, he was told to fight. So if duty and circumstances demand, fight. But fight as an instrument of the divine. So he was told, nimitta matram bhava. Fight without enmity for the opponent. I'm not saying fight without enmity for the enemy. Once we call him an enemy, then there will be an enmity. So fight, he's an opponent, not an enemy. So fight without a sense of enmity for the opponent. Feel a fight wholeheartedly, which means put your best into it. Whatever we do as instruments of the divine, we should put all our heart and soul into it. And why that is important is because what is again important is that in spite of all this, we should leave the outcome to the divine. The outcome is not in our own hands. So even if the outcome turns out to be opposite of what we had expected, we do not mind it. We accept it with equality. That is, we accept that also with equal delight. Now, this is sometimes used to justify half-hearted action. If what has to happen will happen anyway, if that has been determined by the divine, as in the Gita, Sri Krishna tells him that the Kauravas have already died for all practical purposes because I have killed them. Mayai vaite nirta puro meva. So if what has to happen will happen anyway, then why put your heart and soul into the work? But then, again, it's important. Do it wholeheartedly. Put all your heart and soul into the work because it has to be offered to the divine and it will be fit be offered to the divine only if one has put one's heart and soul into the work. So fight as an instrument of the divine. Fight without enmity for the opponent. Fight wholeheartedly and yet leave the outcome to the divine. Do not be attached to the outcome. You may expect a certain outcome, but do not be attached to it. Accept the outcome, even if it is just the opposite of what you expected, with equal delight. Accept that also. Whatever outcome it is, accept it with equal delight. In short, fight when necessary, but fight the right way for right reasons. This particular passage, which I discussed, occurs in the first series of essays in Essays on the Gita by Sri Aurobindo, and it is chapter 20. Chapter 20, among the first series of essays in Sri Aurobindo's Essays on the Gita. Thank you.